Good afternoon, King of the Nations Church. Hi, family. Hi, everyone else who's joining. Thank you so much for deciding to spend your Sunday afternoon with us. We're so happy that you're here. And we just want to give you a warm welcome to this family. I want to start off worship by reading Psalms 8. It's actually, I feel like I say everything's my favorite, but I feel like the Lord is calling us today to just behold Him, behold His majesty, behold His greatness, His vastness, you know, like He's huge. And so I think that's really, and I know we'll never fully understand, but let's see what the psalmist had to say about it, right? So Psalms 8, it says, Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory in the heavens. Through the praise of children and infants, you have established a stronghold against your enemies to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, I think, what is mankind that you are mindful of them, human beings that you care for them? Have you ever thought about that? I know I have. Who am I for you to even think of me, right? Verse 5, it says, you have made them, or you have made us, a little lower than angels and crowned them with glory and honor. You have made them rulers over the works of your hands. You put everything under their feet. Listen to this. It speaks of dominion and authority, right? Verse 7, all flocks and herds and the animals of the wild, the birds in the skies, the fish in the sea, all that swim the paths of the seas. Verse 9, Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all of the earth. And so today, Heavenly Father, we stand here recognizing your majesty. We recognize your beauty. We recognize your holiness. We want to worship you, Lord, the way that you deserve. And so I pray, God, that you would give us fresh eyes. I even feel the Lord restoring innocence this morning. Or this afternoon, I feel like he even mentioned, like, through the mouths of babies, right? Like, that's innocence. And I feel like the Lord is going to restore our innocence in this place as we worship him. He's going to make all things right, and he's bringing purity. Heavenly Father, I thank you that as we worship you, Lord, we don't just get lost and wrapped up in it, God, but you tell us who we are. As we recognize who you are, you tell us who we are. And so we want to praise you, God. We want to worship you with everything that's in our hearts, Lord. You are worthy and deserving. You're worthy and deserving. You're worthy and deserving. Let our praise come, and let our songs be a are just saying, we welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, thank you.
Come let us bow down before for your grace that continues to give us strength when we are weak. You fill our hearts with your mercy and your love, and you continue to shower us with your warmth, your joy. We thank you, Jesus, for who you are and what you've done so far in our lives. We ask that you continue to cover this country. We pray for the new leaders of this country, Lord Jesus. We lift them up to you, God. We just pray for wisdom. We pray for strength. We pray that you cover them, Lord Jesus. You are our Lord, our rock, and our strength. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Rey de las Naciones, or good afternoon, King of the Nations. Pastor Greg Zetz here. It is a joy to be with you again, and I want to thank Jeremy and his team for leading us into an encounter with the living God. We are worshiping a God that's crazy about us, and we're crazy about him. I'm excited about what the Holy Spirit is doing this week. What a win for us. The 3 days of prayer and fasting, people came out, they interceded, they poured out their hearts, and that's going to create a momentum over this ministry, and we're going to see the results of the intercession that we invested in the 3 days of prayer and fasting. So listen, guys, we have a lot to cover today, but before we get into the Word, I just want to remind you, this week, we've been signing up for life groups. And it's very, very important that we connect with a life group. Here's the deal. Our vision is to equip people to be lovers of God and a blessing to the nations. And so you're part of that vision. And what we want to do is we want to make disciples. What we want to do is we want to see people get set free and walk in the liberty and the fullness of the Holy Spirit. What we want to do is equip you for your calling so that you can walk in that which God has destined you to walk in. So it's very, very important that we take these life groups seriously. And I want to encourage you to prayerfully seek what God has for you concerning these life groups. I'll be starting through the Bible next Wednesday night. We're going to be in 2 Thessalonians. We have a good time on Wednesdays. So you can sign up for the Through the Bible, and we'll be finishing up with the book of Revelation in the springtime. So, my dear friends, I have a word for you today. We're in the middle of a series called Prayer is Powerful. Do you believe that prayer is powerful? I believe prayer is powerful, that prayer changes things. First dynamic that the prayer of a righteous man or a woman accomplishes is that prayer changes us. Amen? So when we seek his presence, we are met by his presence when we pray, and he changes us from the inside out. There's a transfiguration that occurs in our inner man that ultimately will manifest through our behavior and in our relationships. Prayer is powerful. Title of today's message is Say Thanks Before the Answer Comes. Say thanks before the answer comes. Let's pray. Father, right now, in the name of your son, Jesus, Lord, I thank you that I am in your presence, even though this building is empty. I thank you that there are holy angels all around. I thank you, Father, that there isn't a vacuum, but there's no distance with you. There's no time with you. And I thank you that as I speak today, the heart of your bride, Jesus, is going to be touched with the revelation of your word. Father, as I speak today, I thank you that hearts are going to be encouraged and hearts are going to be taught and instructed in the ways of your kingdom. And I pray that you would help me Lord, I thank you for the liberty that's in Jesus to be here today to declare to my friends what your word says about prayer. So meet us now, I pray, these next few minutes in Jesus' name. Praise the Lord. The Lord is good. Why don't we just pray the whole time? Okay, I want you to turn with me to Colossians, the fourth chapter. Colossians chapter 4. Colossians, the fourth chapter. Again, say thanks before the answer comes. Paul is in prison. He's writing to a church that he did not start, but he had connections with, that he had relationships with. And he's in prison. He's in chains. And he's speaking to the brothers and sisters in Christ. He's admonishing them and encouraging them. It's very important that we have that dynamic of being admonished and encouraged and instructed. And sometimes we need to be rebuked to get back in alignment. Paul didn't hold anything back. And he says this, it's really Colossians chapter 4, verses 2 and 3. He says, devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful, and pray for us too, that God may open a door for our message so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ, for which I am in chains. Pray that I may proclaim it clearly as I should. Look at that line again. Devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful. In this passage, the Apostle Paul is calling believers to a life of prayer. Devote yourself is written in the present tense, and it urges us to be devoted to persistent prayer. Let me ask you a question. What are you devoted to? An athletic team? Is your team playing today? The Buffalo Bills, the Buffalo Bills, the Kansas City Chiefs, the Green Bay Packers, or Tampa Bay with Tom Brady? Are you devoted to an athletic team, to a soccer team? Are you devoted to your job? Are you devoted to staying in shape? Are you devoted to your kids? See, devotion is good. Devotion creates a focus. A type of devotion creates a focus within us. There is a embracing of that which we are committed to, and it becomes a priority. And there's some things we're devoted to that really aren't eternal. They're not a priority in God's heart, but yet we find ourselves devoted to specific things. In Acts chapter 2 and verse 42, Luke writes, they've devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, that's life groups, and to the breaking of bread, and look at this, and to prayer. Paul believed that prayer was powerful, or else he wouldn't ask the church to pray for him. Paul depended on prayer. We must depend on prayer. Yesterday I was reading, and I came across a statement that this man made, J. Sidlow Baxter. He was a man from England, a great teacher, great teacher. Anything that J. Sidlow Baxter has written, I would encourage you to read. And he said this, he said, there's nothing else worth living for but to get to know Jesus better and better and better. Beloved, you get to know a person by spending time with them. You get to know our God through prayer and being in his presence. Listen, all interaction and prayer flows out of our relationship with the Heavenly Father. Your view of who he is in your life, your understanding of how he sees you and what he says about you will determine if you're persistent in prayer, will determine if you will pray consistently. It says in Jude, verse 1 and verse 1, to those who have been called, who are loved by God the Father, and get this, the Good Shepherd, and kept by Jesus Christ. I assure you today that you are loved by God the Father. So I want to go into this message, say thanks before the answer comes. It's a very, very important message. And there's principles here that we really need to apply in our lives if we're going to be effective in prayer. Paul also knows that without being devoted to ongoing prayer, there will be no watching. This implies that when we are in prayer, we are aware of what the Holy Spirit wants to do. But not only that, we also know what our adversary is doing. What does Jesus say in Matthew 26 and verse 41 in the Garden of Gethsemane to his disciples who were not watching, but they were sleeping? What does he say? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation, for the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Patterns of failure in our walk with the Lord because of temptation typically occur because of prayerlessness, because we're not watching, because we're not seeking the Lord in prayer. Our spiritual immune system grows weak when we're not in prayer. Hear me now. Listen to me. And because the devil seeks to tempt us and attack us to get us out of that place of prayer, we don't have the spiritual immune system to fight the virus of temptation that comes against our mind, that seeks to entice our appetites or the lust of the eyes or the lust of the flesh. And consequently, we stumble and we fail and we fall flat on our face. And thank goodness, because of the Father's mercy, we have grace to repent and get back up on our feet again. So let's just break this open today and get an understanding of what all this means for us. God speaks to men and women who pray. And there's another part to this passage that's a very important ingredient to prayer, and that is thanksgiving. Now, look at this. Suppose I called you and said that I'm going to pay your car payment every month for the next year by sending you a check. You'd be pretty happy, wouldn't you? I'm not going to do it, so don't get any ideas. When would you start thanking me? While we're on the phone or after the check has arrived? And this passage is saying to us, say thanks before the answer comes. Look at it again. Devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful. This passage is saying to us, say thanks before the answer comes. When we say thanks before the answer comes, listen, that is faith. When we give thanks after the answer comes, that's called gratitude. We need both. We need to be a people that say thanks to the Father when the answer comes, when the breakthrough comes, when the divine intervention comes into our situation, and there's a breakthrough where we've been living in a place of setbacks in our life. God shows up, hears our cry, brings freedom, brings provision. That's when we say, oh, thank you, Father. You are a good, good Father. But what I'm after today is something that's even a little deeper than that. When we say thanks before the answer comes, that is faith. Jesus, I love this passage. This moves my heart. In John chapter 11, Jesus is outside the tomb of Lazarus. And look what he says before he raises them from the dead. So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I know that you always hear me. Do we have that confidence in prayer today? But I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. Look at it again. Father, I thank you that you have heard me. Jesus is thanking the Father before the answer comes, before Lazarus is raised from the grave. Very important principle. And here's what I'm after. And this is what I've preached for years. And this is a very, very important truth. Jesus models for us the relationship that we are called to have with the Father. Luke chapter 11, verse 1. After Jesus prayed in a certain place, his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us how to pray. When you pray, say, Father. The relationship, guys, that I have with the Father that I've been modeling for you can be your relationship. I have called him Abba. You will call him Abba. He loves me the way he loves you. The measure of the Father's love for me, says Jesus in John 17, is the measure of love that he has for you. The way I depend on him, you can depend on him. The way I believe that he's going to answer my cry, you can believe that he's going to answer your cry. The way that he delights in me as his son, he delights in you as well. Please capture this. This is a very, very important point. Father, I thank you that you have heard me. So he's saying thanks by faith before Lazarus is raised from the dead. Okay, let's break this open here. Saying thanks before the answer comes, number one, is an act of faith. Devote yourself to prayer, being watchful and thankful. Being watchful and thankful will make us ready for the answer to our prayer. When I thank God before the breakthrough comes, I am trusting that my Heavenly Father has already sent the check in the mail. Just because I don't see the answer immediately doesn't mean God hasn't heard me. Let me say that again, because there's a spiritual battle going on in some of our lives. Just because I don't see the answer immediately doesn't mean that God hasn't heard me. Remember Daniel chapter 10? The angel says to Daniel, from the first day that you have set your heart on gaining understanding, you were heard. The first day. How long did it take for the breakthrough to come, for the answer to come? 21 days. Why didn't it come day two? Because there was a spiritual battle going on in the heavenly realms, and the prince of Persia, that principality over the kingdom of Persia, it's a big, big demon. But the big, big demons that are principalities over geographic locations like Washington, D.C. and São Paulo, Brazil, or Mexico City, or Berlin, Germany, or London, England. These big, big principalities and powers, guess what? What Paul reveals in Ephesians chapter 6, that we have authority over them and that they are under our feet. But this big, big demon called a principality, the prince of Persia, was seeking to keep the angel from bringing the answer to Daniel. And what did he do? He persevered in prayer. Jen Armin, I don't know who Jen is, but I found this quote and I love it and I want to share it with you. She says, waiting is incredibly difficult for us because we tend to only believe we receive those things we can see with our eyes. This requires that we believe we receive things that we can't see or touch yet. We can't look up a postal or a UPS tracking code for them. Have you ever done that before? I have. We simply have to believe that God will do what he promised. Look at that. Just like Jesus, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. We need to believe that God will do what he has promised. Andrew Murray, who's written over 50 books on prayer, lived in South Africa, man of God, had a connection with the Father, and out of his experience with the Father, he wrote about prayer, and he says this, look at this, this grips my heart. God rules the world and his church through the prayer of his people. God rules the world and his church through the prayer of his people. That God should have made the expansion of his kingdom to such a large extent dependent on the faithfulness of his people in prayer is a stupendous mystery and yet an absolute certainty. Whoa. Listen, guys, when we pray, the Holy Spirit acts and the devil reacts. And that's why we need to be a people of faith. That's why we need to be a people that trust our Father. That's why we need a revelation that he is a good, good Father and he cares for us. We're loved by him. He hears our cry. He knows where we are. He sees what's going on. Some of you have situations that look and seem dead. Finances, your marriage, your job situation, relationships. Don't complain about it. Pray into those situations and thank God for resurrection power that will bring the answer, that will bring the breakthrough. And this is where, beloved, like I said last week, we've got to get out of the high chair. We've got to grow up. We have to mature. Maturity equals Christ-likeness. We're sons of God. We're priests of the kingdom. We're loved by him. We've been loosed by our sins through the blood of Jesus. We can have complete access. And in that access, we have freedom and confidence to pray and cry out to our Father. But what do we do between the time that we pray and the time that the answer comes? That's where we need to grow and mature in our understanding of what this means. Mark 11, 22 through 25. Very, very popular or very popular verse among the faith camp. And it says, have faith in God, Jesus answered. Truly, I tell you, if anyone says to this mountain, go throw yourself into the sea, and does not doubt in their heart, but believes that what they say will happen, it will be done for them. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours. Believe that you have received it, and it will be yours. So we begin to pray according to God's will over a situation. There is a faith that says, you know what? The Father has this, and he's going to provide, and I believe that the answer is going to come. It's just, again, it's just like our friend who, George Mueller, who prayed 63 years for a friend to come to Christ. A man who had over 50,000 answers to prayer. And here's this last friend of his that he's been praying for all these years. He comes to Christ at George Mueller's funeral. But it was like it's a done deal. I believe that the answer is coming. I believe that my friend's going to come to Christ. That's the confidence I'm talking about. That keeps us from complaining. That keeps us from being offended at God. That keeps us from self-pity. That keeps us from withdrawing into a cocoon of demonic oppression where we're not free to commune with the Lord because we have looked through a lens of unbelief. Let me tell you, when we don't nourish ourselves on the Word of God, we will develop unbelief. We will develop a spiritual condition of unbelief. And even Hebrews talks about this, about let none of you have an unbelieving and perverse heart. Don't let your heart get hard. We draw conclusions based on our perspective. You know, I prayed for 2 weeks. God hasn't answered my prayer about a job and I blah, 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 blah. He's trying to mature us. He's trying to grow us up. He's seeking to show us that there's a divine timetable for the breakthrough to come. Can we trust him? Can we trust him? And then he goes on to say in Mark, and when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them so that your Father in heaven may forgive you your sins. Now, we may address this next week as we do a few more messages on prayer, because I think it's vital going into 2021. The nation is divided. Some people are happy about the new president, and you know, half the nation isn't happy. I'm full of joy in the spirit. I don't look for happiness over conditions that I see going on around me. That isn't what makes me happy. What makes me happy is the joy of Jesus. But I'm sober about this because as a church, we have a responsibility to be praying, to intercede for our president. We have a new president, a new administration. We have the responsibility to intercede for President Biden. Very, very important. 1 Timothy chapter 2, that keeps our heart right. But can we pray believing prayer? Can we pray the word of God into his life? Can we pray the word of God into the vice president's life? Can we stand secure because of love and walk in authority and intercede? So I'm teaching these messages on prayer because we really need to be equipped. And I'm so excited. I was so excited, guys, by what I saw Sunday night, Monday night, Tuesday night. Childlike faith, people praying with authority. The joy of the Lord in our midst, a unity of spirit and purpose. My goodness, if we carry that into this new year together, even though we're apart, we're going to see powerful things happen. But we must become a people that say thanks before the answer comes. Amen? Praise the Lord. Luke chapter 1 tells the story of a man named Zechariah. Zechariah was the father of John the Baptist. Can you imagine being the father of John the Baptist? This is a beautiful story. Let's read this real quick. When Zechariah saw an angel. Here's Zechariah. He's a priest, and his tribe, his unit, got called up, and they had to serve in the temple. They cast lots, and the lot fell on Zechariah. And Zechariah was chosen to go into the temple and light the incense, okay? So it was a great honor to do this. And Zechariah is an old man. And so he goes back there, and an angel shows up to the right side of the altar where the incense was burning. There's something very prophetic about that, but we won't go into it for the sake of time. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and was gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to call him John." And Zechariah asked the angel, "How can I be sure of this? I am an old man, and my wife is well along in years." The angel said to him, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God." I love this. "And I have been sent to speak to you and to tell you this good news. And now you will be silent and not able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their appointed time." God heard the cry of this man many years earlier, and with the passing of time, Zechariah gave up. There was no watching or giving thanks for the answer to his prayer. Delay doesn't mean denial. God's timing is perfect, and he's never late. Say it with me. God is always on time. Come on, I can't hear you. Say it again. God is always on time. Have you given up on a promise that you were believing to receive? Jesus said we should always pray and not give up or not lose heart. Listen, this is what I've learned. When I can't see God's hand, I trust his heart. When I can't see God's hand in the situation after I pray, I trust his heart because I know he's faithful and he's heard my cry. You know, in Luke, at the beginning of this passage, it speaks of their age. It speaks of the fact that she was barren. And here's what happened, guys. Here's what happened. This man prayed for his wife. I think about Jacob praying for his wife, Rachel, and Isaac doing the same, because Isaac's wife, Rebecca, was barren, and Rachel was barren. And of course, Sarah was barren. So we got something generational going on there between Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. You join the Freedom Life Group, and you'll learn something about generational sin and bondages and things like that. Well, God brings a breakthrough, and of course, Rachel has a child. And here's this woman who's barren. So he marries a barren woman. And Zechariah, the Bible says he's a righteous man and he obeyed the ordinances of the Lord. I guarantee you, as a young man, Zechariah was like, "Honey, come on, let's fast. Let's pray. I'm going to pray over your womb. Come on, before we go to bed, I'm going to pray over your womb. And he did that and he was committed to that. But this passage teaches us that he wasn't ready for the answer to his prayer. He had lost his way. He had gotten discouraged. There was a sense of just living with the condition that he found his wife in. I'm just going to tolerate it. I guess God didn't hear me. I guess God isn't going to bring the breakthrough after all. And you're too old anyway. Maybe if he would have read his Bible, he would discover that Sarah was 90 years old and Abraham was 100 years old. See, there's nothing impossible with our God. Absolutely nothing impossible with our God. And whether there's death, whether there's barrenness, whether there's sickness, God is greater than all of those things, and he trumps all of those things, and he can work in any and every situation. We need to learn to say thanks before the answer comes. God heard the cry of this man many years earlier. And with the passing of time, Zechariah gave up. Don't give up. Don't give up. Don't give up, guys. Don't give up. Don't give up. Don't give up. Let's stand in a place of assurance today, knowing that God has heard our cry. Number two, saying thanks before the answer comes guards our heart from spiritual attack. Look at this, Philippians chapter 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let me just say this, rejoicing is an indicator that you are winning the spiritual battle, even though you may be facing setbacks and opposition. Let me say that again. Rejoicing is an indicator that you are winning the spiritual battle, even though you may be facing setbacks and opposition. Paul's in prison when he writes this, by the way, and he says rejoice. See, again, the conditions around him did not determine what was going on in him. And it shouldn't affect us as well. The conditions around us, the situations we're in, should not determine what's going on within. Do you have a song today? Are you rejoicing in the God of your salvation? Is there a dance? Do you dance unto the Lord? My knee's getting better. I'm getting closer to dancing. Amen? Hallelujah. Let me read on. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, there it is, with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your heart and your minds in Christ Jesus. God's peace will come when we pray and give thanks for the answer in advance. The spiritual attack will come directly against our mind to discourage and dismantle the focus that we have. This is where many Christians lose the battle, beloved. This is where many of us lose the battle and we give up. The narrative that you listen to will determine if the breakthrough comes. This is where we must guard against developing an unbelieving heart. Very important. When I believe the word of God for my life, it lifts me above my circumstances, negative reports, hopelessness, and fear. The Bible is filled with what God wants to say to us. Persistence in prayer overcomes the resistance that comes against our lives. Very, very important. Our spiritual battle, guys, is usually centered on a narrative that Satan uses to try to stop us. It will always be a contradiction to what God says in his word. Let me say that again. It will always be a contradiction to what God says in his word. The devil attacks with doubts, accusations, temptations, and anything else he can use to keep us from praying and expecting breakthrough. The devil defeated Adam and Eve in the garden by talking to them, and that is how he seeks to defeat us as well. How is the enemy overcoming you, or is he? What narrative are you listening to? He talked to Adam. He talked to Eve. There was a deception that they believed. They were deceived. They became disconnected from the God of glory, who loved them, who was there, who was with them. And Adam fell. And that's what happens to us. That's what's happened to me. There is this sense of listening to the narrative, listening to the doubts, listening to the accusations. Why bother? Why pray? And I tell you, that's a dark place. We need our heart guarded. And I'm telling you, when we give thanks and we praise the Lord, when we praise the Lord and give thanks for the answer, it guards our heart from spiritual attack. And it also does something else. It guards us from the "what have you done for me lately" attitude. We can fall into that very easily. Lord, what have you done for me lately? Now, would we say that? No, but we live that way. We think that way. And I'm telling you, when you praise the Lord and you declare a heart of gratitude, you thank the Lord in faith for that answer, let me tell you, it will protect you from all kinds of things that could truly sour our spirit and defile us and keep us from walking in the grace of God and the joy of our salvation. Lastly, saying thank you before the answer comes, it's an expression of praise. I like this. Now, let's just look at Abraham here in Romans chapter 4. Look at this. Without weakening in his faith, he faced the fact that his body was as good as dead since he was about 100 years old, and that Sarah's womb was also dead. Yet he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had power to do what he had promised. In other words, Abraham came into a place and gave God glory. Same thing. Acknowledging God that he's going to fulfill the promise that he gave him 25 years earlier. Can we walk in a place of gratitude and thanksgiving for 25 years before the answer comes? You see, that's what friendship with God is built upon. Because Abraham grew in his faith by walking with God and hearing God. He didn't have the Holy Spirit dwelling in him like you and I do, but he became a friend of God over time by walking with him and talking to him and listening to the God of glory. And Abraham gave thanks to God. He gave glory to God. It's very, very important. Look what it says. Being fully persuaded that God had the power to do what he had promised. Are you fully persuaded that God has the power to do what he has promised in your life? This is the place of tension. This is the place where we grow and mature and we develop humility and confidence. This is the place where we grow in rest. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your mind and your heart. That's an indicator that you are walking in a place of rest and trust and peace, and you're living from the inside out. Wow, it's powerful. And let me just tell you something. I don't always live there. This morning I was disturbed. Got up, sought the Lord, started to pray, processing the word, feeling good about what God is saying and what he's going to do. And then all kinds of things started coming against my mind. Frustration, anger, just this looking through a natural lens, even at our nation. And it started to bug me. And I'm like, I'm losing my peace right now. What in the world is going on here? This is the place of battle. And I don't always walk in it. And that's why with energy, I can talk about this and teach on these principles, because I'm striving in the grace of God to live in this place. And I've been walking with Jesus almost 40 years now. We're always growing. We're always maturing. We're always developing. We're always going deeper. And it's very, very important for us to embrace the pathway of a disciple. And he's teaching us many things. Jürgen Mathesius, he's a pastor in Australia. And he wrote this. I found this very, very helpful. Too many people think that praise is reserved for rewarding God for a job well done and not before. Because we have been brought up in a dysfunctional world of performance-based acceptance, we treat God the same way our parents treated us. When we did well, we were praised. But when we did poorly, we were scolded or ignored. But God is good all the time. And even though you and I may be facing a storm, we must remember the words of David. The Lord is enthroned at the flood. Or over the flood. Faith is praising God for his goodness when you don't see it, for his loving kindness when you don't feel it, and for his faithfulness when you haven't yet received it. I like that. That's a good quote right there. Again, when we say thanks before the answer comes, that is faith. When we give thanks after the answer comes, it's called gratitude. Let's go back to the illustration. Suppose I called you and said that I am going to pay your car payment every month for the next year by sending you a check. When would you start thanking me? While we were on the phone or after the check had arrived? This passage is saying to us, say thanks before the answer comes. Now think about the areas of your life that you need breakthrough in. You know, it's interesting, someone that I've been praying for many times, and I want to encourage you, find that one person. It's going to expand into many, I guarantee you. And by the grace of God, every day I've got a list that's growing, and I'm praying, and I'm lifting these people up. Today, I just spoke prophetically over them. I thank you for so-and-so and what she's going to do and the call upon her life. These people are lost. These are people in my life, most of them classmates, that I know are a breath away from hell. But I'm intentionally going before the Father, and I'm saying thank you for what's going to happen in their life because of the breakthrough that's going to come because of prayer. And it's interesting, a guy that I had on my heart that I went to high school with, guess what happened? This is how the prayer works. God begins to bring these little intersections of mercy together. He friends me on Facebook out of the blue. I haven't talked to him in close to 6 years. He friends me, and I'm in dialogue with him. I sent him a message. Hey, why not? This is what I'm talking about, believing prayer, interceding, God opening up doors, God doing what he said he'll do. Again, look at Zechariah. A lot fell on him. God had something to do with that. He was chosen. God brought him into the temple because of his responsibilities, because he was faithful. And an angel appears to him and gives a birth announcement before she was pregnant, before Elizabeth was pregnant and she was barren. And so he was a mute for 9 months. But guess what he did that night? Yes, that's right. He spent time with his wife and they were intimate and she got pregnant. That's what the passage teaches us. And maybe it wasn't that night, maybe it was the next day. But he had to do his part. That's a whole nother message in walking in faith. We have to do our part through the grace of God. I thought I would just give you an example of a prayer. I wrote this this morning. This is what I'm talking about. Your prayer may look like this. Father, in Jesus' name, I give you thanks for hearing my cry today, for you are the God who hears and answers. I thank you for the breakthrough that is mine. I thank you in advance for the provision that I need, for you are a good Father, and I praise you for your faithfulness in my life, for you have remembered me in your mercy time and time again. I will rise to give you thanks day by day, for you are worthy to be praised. Thank you for your care for me and my family. In Jesus' name, amen. That's an example of what I'm talking about. A prayer that really honors the Lord and recognizes that he is sovereign and he is great and he is all-powerful and nothing is too hard for him. And listen, this is where we grow day by day in praise, in worship. We meditate on the Psalms. We open the Psalms up and we pray the Psalms and we give thanks. And your prayer, it may come be answered next week or next month or next year. That's not what's important. What's important is the focus of our heart, the devotion of our heart. Does a lack of breakthrough determine how my heart's going to respond to the Word and the Spirit? That's the question of the hour. And so we must come into a place of growing in what I'm talking about today. What a joy. What a joy. Let me give you these points again. Saying thanks before the answer comes. It is an act of faith. It's an act of faith. Secondly, it guards our heart from spiritual attack. Thirdly, it's an expression of praise. I love it. This is good, King of the Nations. Rey de las Naciones. This is good, my brothers and sisters. This is really good, Jack Rafferty. This is good, David Sad. This is good, John Zetz. This is good, my brothers and sisters, and God will give us grace to implement this word today. Let's pray. There's some that are watching this today. Maybe you're viewing this message a few days after it was originally presented, and there's a cry in your heart. It's the cry of desperation. It's the cry of a lonely place because you don't know my Jesus yet. And there's a cry in your heart saying, I want what he's talking about. I want a relationship with the living God. I want to pray. And guess what? God has heard your prayer. That's why you're watching this. And this is an answer to your prayer, and I'm talking to you right now. And to enter into what I'm talking about here, you have to become a child of God. And to become a child of God, it's not our own doing. We can't make ourselves into children of God. It's the doing of God. It's the work of his Spirit. It's done through the Holy Spirit coming to dwell inside of you. Jesus, listen to me. Jesus died on the cross for you. Your sin put him on that cross, and he died for you so that you would not walk in your sin and have that separate you from the Father any longer. And so the good news of the gospel is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. He died for you, and he wants your heart. And here's what I want you to do. I want you to pray with me now, just a prayer of surrender, a prayer of acknowledging that you're guilty, as the Bible teaches that the whole world is guilty. And so I want you to pray with me right now. Just say, Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, I want you. And I turn from my sin. I turn from my selfishness. And I take my spiritual condition and I give it to you. And I ask you to fix me. Friend, only God can fix us. And so just say, Jesus, be my Savior and be my Lord. Come into my heart through the Holy Spirit. Come and live in me right now. Come and set me free. I want to know your presence. I want to know your love. And just open your heart right now and just say, Jesus, be the Lord of my life and be my Savior and set me free and give me a new beginning. in Jesus' name. If you prayed that prayer, I want you to let us know. And just touch base with us. The email, everything is there, the phone number. Please let us know if we can do anything for you. Because this is life and death. And what you have done is the most important decision that you'll ever make in your life, surrendering your life to Christ. I did it almost 40 years ago now, April 12, 1981, and my life has never been the same. Church, I love you. We'll continue this series next week. I'll see you through the Bible. Those of you that have signed up for my group, 2 Thessalonians, read it. Let's go for it, guys. Let's make disciples. Let's get equipped. Let's see the church empowered to be Jesus to this nation, to our region. Our region needs us. Amen. So that's what we're after, to equip believers to be lovers of God and a blessing to the nations. Amen. I want to encourage you to continue your giving. It's wonderful what's going on next door in the children's building. It's transformative. And so we're going to be opening up with a new children's building and all renovated and clean for our little disciples. And so, but we need money, and we don't want to lack. And I just want to encourage you to be faithful to and honor your giving to the Lord. Amen. May the Lord richly bless you. I'll see you real soon. In Jesus' name, amen.